Welcome, everyone, to our next in the series of small talks on big data. Today, we are very privileged to have Dr. Sakamoto talking about some of his groundbreaking work in this area. And he's going to be talking about minimizing the spread of false tweets during disaster response, especially tied to the East Japan earthquake. So with that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Sakamoto.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, everyone, for coming. So yeah, today I'm going to talk about my research with two PhD students and a postdoc who I used to work here, but she's now back in Japan, and two PhD students actually here. So yeah, going back a little bit, so I study behavior in social media, how people make decisions in social media, and I focus on individuals, both individual level and group level. So how individuals make decisions and how that influences other people's decisions, and collectively, how does social media behave, for example. And so, and previously my application was more in marketing. Like, you know, how can we predict trend, what kind of items become popular, and by studying social media behavior, we can get some insights about it. So yeah, before, my application was closer to customer analytics, but this earthquake happened, and my research took a different direction. And so now my application, I focus a lot of my time on actually applying social media analysis to disaster management. And so I'm going to present that line of work today. But so yeah, what happened? So I guess, yeah, you can't see this, but so one of the overall goal we have is to improve the effectiveness of social media for disaster response. And so, yeah, to do that, one approach we have is to minimize the spread of false information in social media during disaster. And so, yeah, I'll expand on this later. And so, but so, yeah, as Chris mentioned, so today the focus is on, we're going back 2 years, and the focus is on the big earthquake that happened in Japan in 2011. And so yeah, I guess, yeah, I'll give you a little bit of background on that too. And so I guess, yeah, so I presented this last month. There was a kind of 2 year anniversary of this earthquake in Japan. So I was invited as a guest speaker there. So I presented 10 minute version of today's talk. I guess I expanded 10 minute talk into maybe like, I don't know, 80 minutes. So you guys have to stay and listen. Well, but let's see. But so when the earthquake happened, it was about 1 a.m. in New Jersey. So I was in New Jersey. Well, actually, by the way, if you don't know me, I'm from Japan. So I was really, really interested in this, this earth, not interested, but it was a big concern for me. And so, but it was 1 a.m. in New Jersey. I was sleeping, and my wife was sleeping. Everyone in my family was sleeping. But my sister-in-law from South Korea called us and woke us up. And she told us, she informed us about this earthquake. There was a big earthquake in Japan. And first I was like, yeah, there's earthquake every month in Japan. Why are you waking us up? But I mean, but I thought maybe it's a big deal. So I started looking online, mostly Twitter, and a little bit of Facebook. And so first I was amazed how much real-time local information we can get from social media. But then, let's say 5 minutes later, I was like so confused because there are too many conflicting messages. So one message might say, oh, yeah, one thing, and another message say completely different things. So I was confused. And I guess I talked about this experience to one of the NSF program directors, and she became interested in this, and we got a grant money to do this project. And so that's how it started. And anything else I need to cover? And so because the talk was 10 minutes when I was invited, I only have one sentence in my talk. That's all I want to say. But I expanded into 80 minutes, one sentence. So it's going to take a while. But so I guess, yeah, rumor spreading crisis, during crisis. And so So this is an example of fourth rumor tree. We know that it's false because later on we verified it. But when during disasters, you actually don't know what's false and what's true. And so this is really one of the challenges we have. But here, you know, we're analyzing after the disaster, so we know we can classify different tweets into, you know, true and false. But so this is an example false rumor tweet, which said an airdrop of supplies is not allowed in Japan. And this was actually, so rumor 8, you would see why it's rumor 8 soon in the next slide, but this tweet was spread for a long time in Twitter, and it influenced a lot of people's behavior. For example, the whole community might go to a supermarket and buy everything they have, and you know, 30 minutes after that, they get a lot of supplies. And so they, yeah, it, I mean, so it has psychologically it's not good, and also you spend money and the store is going to be in trouble too. And so this is an example of tweet, and we'll be analyzing this kind of tweet in the work I present here. We analyze this kind of tweet, but so the fact, the phenomenon that rumor spread during crisis, earthquake, is not so new. So this person Prasad, in 1950, he analyzed, the researcher analyzed major earthquakes in the past 1,000 years. I don't know how, it's done, but in his paper, he talks about all these earthquakes, and he found out that the same types of rumors actually spread. And so I guess humans never learn. They always spread the same types of rumors. But so this is not big news. So here, so this is a visualization of rumor spread from our own data set. And so what we have here is, so the top half, all these are examples of false rumors. And each box is a tweet, a false tweet. And let's see, on the y-axis have a number of days in log scale. And so the first, you can't see the line, but there's 1 day. And then the next line is 7 days, and 14 days, 2 weeks, and 3 weeks. And so rumor 8, the one you just saw before, was this one, the last one. And this one was spread about 21 days. And so, each dot is a retweet, and the size of the dot represents the number of followers of the retweeter.
What kind of software do you use to visualize the data?
Visualize the data, this is all done in R.
In R?
R, yes. Oh, feel free to ask questions. I usually don't make sense, so, I mean, that's cool, yeah. So please stop me and ask questions, and yeah, I can clarify. Try to clarify, and the two PhD students are better explainer than me. So, and so yeah. So here we have false rumors, visualizing the spread. So even for false rumors, they typically they don't survive longer than a week. They tend to die after a few days, but some can survive for long time. 3 weeks. And so rumor two, this one was actually about some worker, instead of taking care of nuclear power plant, he decided to go to a bar and drink or something like that. Something about, not making fun, but something about not doing, what the person was supposed to do. Something about responsibility, I guess. I'm not really sure, but you might spread that because you want to, penalize that person. Let's see. And so one last thing about this top half of this figure is it's ordered by the number of followers of the original person who tweeted. And so there is some relationship, right? You can see the more followers a person has, that person's false tweets are going to spread longer. And so in the bottom, so it's the same type of visualization, but this, all these tweets come from a Twitter account of Japanese prime minister. And so this is government account, and mostly it's about useful information. And let's see, yeah, so the eighth one that spread longer than others, this was actually announcement that there are false rumors in social media, so be careful. Anyway, so, but might not be clear, but here I'm just showing eight examples, but there are a lot more. And when we do statistical analysis, actually, you can say that false rumors spread longer than the government tweets. And maybe not more if you see there are a lot of retweets for the government tweets too. It's just the length is different. False rumors tend to spread longer. Moving on, this is NHK is one of the major news media, and their tweets are not, yeah, they don't spread as long as the false rumor tweets. Yeah. So there are variability. So this one is in the evening, there are some morning ones, and so in general, it's the same. I'm just showing eight, so you might see some differences. So during, when they're sleeping, they're not retweeting so much, usually. Yeah, so something like this is clear. So at night, everyone's retweeting. They decide to go to sleep. In the morning, they retweet again. And so you would see some different patterns depending on when you post the data. So this is another news media in Japan. And again, I guess my point here is that false rumors can spread long. Most of the other tweets, they usually die within one day. So this is the one day line. Line is missing, but so they don't spread longer than one. So they might get a lot of retweets immediately after, but they die down. Yeah, getcha?
For each rumor, mm-hmm. I know the y-axis is the days, right? Uh-huh. So what's the x-axis?
Oh, very good question. X-axis is nothing. It's just jitter. It's if I just have a single one, sometimes there's a big circle and it's going to cover everything, so just random so that we can see some pattern in here. And so I guess, the point is rumor spread, so it's something we need to worry about. And so I guess rumor spreads not just during earthquake, but more recent example. The most recent one was, which one was most recent? Well, yeah, anyway, so when Hurricane Sandy came, there was a lot of rumors spread on social media too, and FEMA was very smart, so they created this rumor control website. And so there's a lot of misinformation circulating on social media, so be careful. And two examples, one was, cash card, and the other one was food stamp. And so these tweets, social media, false tweets spread. And FEMA was able to quickly create this web page, and actually we are analyzing the effect of this, creating this web page on minimizing the spread of rumor too. And so another example, so this is another natural disaster, and this is more man-made disaster. So it was, again, Sandy, but Sandy Hook massacre, the mass shooting that happened at school. And so in this too, social media users spreading false information about Sandy Hook massacre could face charges. And so out of misinformation spread here too. Also, they actually, so I guess, it's reaction actually. Specifically says there's a false rumor about cash card, and point to specific tweet and say this is false with big X. And if you need more information, contact this number, go to this web page. So it's,
Did it stop the propagation of the tweet?
Yeah, so that's a good question. We're analyzing it right now. It So it seems like the early result is mixed. It seems like for certain type of tweets, it might. Other tweets, yeah, maybe not. And maybe that might be due to the time effect too. Like you said, when everyone's sleeping, this doesn't help. Like Jean said. But yeah. But so another one. So I don't know if you know this web page, but they actually have a really good interactive visualization of rumor spread. But it's for England's summer of disorder. There were a few examples. One was mostly about riots. But they have this visualization. I have an image later on how they visualize rumor spread in a few slides later, I think. But here too, they categorize tweets into rumors and oppositions. Those that counter the rumor. No, that cannot be true. And some questions. Yeah, some tweets that question the rumors. And then there was something else. But they color code those and visualize it. And what they found was, and what we are finding too, was once rumors spread, counter tweets appear very quickly. So it's Twitter and social media in general, they're very good at correcting themselves. Also, rumor happens, but very quickly counter tweets happen. So the self-correcting nature is good, but at the same time, we are seeing this, and their visualization show this too. But after the counter tweets appear, people still spread rumors, and so it's not really helping. And so that one of the problem is that social media, it's information overload, so you can't see every piece of information. So many people, although counter tweets exist in social media, maybe you just don't see them. And so you cannot use that information. So one of the study I'm going to show today here soon is that maybe we can just link those two. And if we have a technology to link those two, that can help minimize the spread of false rumors. But so yeah, I guess it's hard to see. But if you're interested, this is really good visualization. So I really wanted to do visualization and also some crowdsourcing technique to minimize the spread of information. But we started to search online, and other people are thinking in similar ways. So they very quickly create websites like this. So it's better to collaborate with them than trying to create our own, if it's the purpose is the same. And so that's what we are actually trying to do. And so what was the first sentence? Not first and the first part. So rumors spread and hide useful information. And so I guess if rumors spread and if it's a mess in social media, why would you use it for disaster response? And that's because informative tweets still exist. And so these rumors are hiding or making it very difficult to find those useful messages, statements. And so, so I guess this part I'm trying to convince it. A lot of information. So informative tweets exist. So, this is a dissertation work actually, trying to figure out, look at the social media information tweets during emergencies in 2010. So, around 2009 and 2010, there are two floods, and they analyzed 20,000 tweets, for example, and they found 80% of those tweets were related to situational awareness. So it had situational information that you can use. Or in this location, there's fire, stay away. And that location information is actually really useful for responders too. They know where to go and fix the problem. And another, in 2010 flood was 9%. And then for Oklahoma fires, they analyzed 3,000 tweets and was 20% informative tweets. In 2010 Haiti earthquake, they had many tweets, but she sampled 4,005 of them and found out that 24% of the tweets were useful. And so another fire, 2010 Australia's fire, the percentage was much higher, 65% had factual details that were useful, and 22% had geographical data, location information. And so, yeah, this is very important. 5% actionable. So, yeah, some tweets could be useful, but it might be very difficult to turn that the information into action. And so 5% was actionable. And then 2011, Thailand's flood, 39% useful, and 8% was request for assistance. And yeah, something like this is really actionable if it has location and I guess 5W1H, I mean details, you know, what they need, who need it, and where it is, and why and how. If you have that kind of information, it really helps. And another study looked at 2011, major events in 2011, 35 million tweets, and they found 30% of those tweets had situational information, and 17% credible. And so I guess, yeah, so for this situational information, some might be useful, but others might be just false, misinformation, rumor. And so, yeah, these previous studies, they don't distinguish. This one was one of the first ones to try to distinguish which ones are credible. And then 2012, Hurricane Sandy, so this most recent one, 34% news and information, and 25% photos and videos. And so they are
not recording false rumors.
No, they're not recording. So yeah, so in this study, we don't know. And I'm pretty sure some of the photos and videos are false, the fake videos too of sharks swimming and so on. But so, but even if it's small percentage, 5%, 8%, the you know, informative tweets exist, so we need to find it. And I don't have statistics for the earthquake in Japan, but I have a few examples, and one famous one is this deputy governor of Tokyo. He was like me, he was in Japan, and he was more serious than I was, but he was staying up all night actually looking Twitter, information in Twitter, so that yeah, he might be able to use this information and help others. Oh, he was also posting tweets about, you know, the gradual reopening of Tokyo subway. And that was really useful. And I think, yeah, when you have information, you become calm. So you don't need to panic if you know what's happening. And yeah, he was helping that. But so here, yeah, he stayed all night like me. But he was doing much better than me because he was classifying all these tweets into actionable and not actionable. And so he wanted to prioritize everything. And the dimension he focused was the detail. If the tweet has enough detail that you can act on, he's going to put it into certain categories that he's going to really focus on. And so this example is, in a disaster center, there was a young boy, junior high school, a young boy whose mother was a school teacher, and they were stuck in the school. So it looked like this. This is not the school, but the area was underwater, and later on there was fire, and so they couldn't really go anywhere, and they were stuck like this. I think they were went outside first on the roof, but then they decided, oh, water is coming high, so we should go even up. So they climbed up some water tank or something like that. And then they were, so students and teachers were over there. But so this young son tweeted the situation. In this location, there are this many people, and my mother is taking care of everyone, and they really can't go anywhere, so they need help. And then, so I guess, local emergency workers, they couldn't help. They were gone, actually, because so the disaster management office was really located really close to the coast, which is a bad choice, because they were the first to to disappear, so no one could help. And so this person was in Tokyo, and so he was trying to help, and he wanted to. So yeah, he was sending a lot of helicopters to this area, but you know, they can't see anything, and it's so difficult to go exactly to know exactly where to go. And so he was looking for tweets and try to navigate those helicopters. So this one tweet was really accurate, and actually, the son's tweet went to his brother was studying in London, so went to London, and so and his brother retweeted from London and went to some business person in Tokyo, and the business person in Tokyo he was somehow connected to this deputy governor, and the information reached the deputy governor's Twitter account. And then, yeah, so based on this information, he told the helicopter to go there and save. And I guess, yeah, in the last slide, I have picture, but everyone was safe, and they sent a thank you note to this governor, and was a, yeah, so in this case, it was happy ending. But so, yes, we want to help make it easier for these decision makers to find useful information. And so one thing, one approach, or one thing we can do is try to minimize the spread of false information. And by doing that, there's less noise to filter out. So we want to minimize the spread of rumor. And so improve social media for disaster response. So that's the main goal. But so one approach we have is developing techniques for minimizing the spread of false information on social media. And we really focus on studying behavior. There are a lot of other computer scientists who are doing something similar, but they really focus on analyzing what exists in tweets and trying to figure out automatic way of classifying different kinds of tweets. But what we do is actually study behavior and change how people post tweets and also how they react to different kinds of tweets. And so by doing that, we are actually trying to make the quality of big data better, improving the quality of the data so that those automatic classification algorithms can be more efficient and effective. But so you see tweets like that. So imagine this is a false tweet. And so something happens in this person's mind. You know, maybe it makes the person anxious or very excited or something like that. And then the person decides if he's going to share this tweet or not. And once you decide, so based on this decision, there's a collective behavior where, you know, tweets spread, for example. What we are studying is this part. What else can we put, for example, to change? So if this was a false tweet, change this person's mind so that he would pick not share decision. And so we are working on this part most of the time. And so people involved in this work. So this is me, two PhD students. And Yuko used to be a postdoc here, but she moved to Tokyo. And we are actually, I mean, so because of the nature of tweets, we are working with people in Japan to their help, and they're also helping us collect data too. But one way to minimize the spread is by using crowdsourcing critical thinking. And so, like, also this is a visualization of the website, the visualization website I mentioned previously. So in this one, green is tweets that support rumor. So this is a rumor about rioters attacking a children's hospital in Birmingham. And this happened to be false, actually, this rumor. But so greens are support, so we want to minimize these supports. Red is oppositions. Those are like counter tweets. And then yellow, orange is questions. And gray, the gray is just comment. Counter tweets, these oppositions grow, but these supports still exist. So if in an ideal world, you want to just see red and green just disappearing altogether. This is, I'm plotting here, so this is toward the end. Yeah, of this event. And so I get, forgot to mention. So there's another group studying actually tweets related to Great East Japan earthquake, like us. And so they found that rumors persist even after counter tweets spread too. And so this is somewhat surprising, but I guess it's not surprising because of the amount of information you get. And so, right. And so, yeah, so we decided, so what happens if we just link the counter tweet and false rumor tweet? So it seems like rumor tweets happen and counter tweets appear, but counter tweets is not helping stop, helping to stop the spread of rumor. So I guess one possibility is that people just don't see it. If we link those two and people know that there's some counter argument to this false information, maybe we can minimize the spread. And so that's exactly what we did. So we did an experiment where we used tweets from Japan, this rumor tweet, and there was a counter tweet. We call it criticism in this case, but airdrop is not prohibited, don't spread false information, something like that. And so in one condition, we showed this information first, and then we showed participants this information and asked how many people would you share this information to. And in another condition, the order was flipped. So we first showed this people, and then asked how many people would you share this information. And then later on, they see this information. And so in the first condition, we call it exposure to criticism condition. Yeah, by the way, this is Yuko, and this is Toshi. And so the result was exposure to criticism. If you show the criticism first, you can reduce the number of responses that says, I'm going to share this information with many people. And so you can increase the response that indicate that I'm going to stop sharing. And so by just linking, so that was about 17% increase. And so this is good news. So if in the real social media, in Twitter, for example, if there's a way to link once you have false information and also counter information, maybe if there's a way to link those two, we should be able to minimize the spread information. So we so this is more like lab experiment, but we are moving toward actually designing a system and testing it online. And so we are exposing people to counter information that counters false tweets, might be able to minimize the spread of false tweets. And we also work with collective opinion too. So in tweets, for example, in Twitter, there are information about retweet, and in other social media, people like or dislike things, and there are collective opinion everywhere. And so how does that influence? Going back a little bit, so there was so we wanted to test what type of statement people like to share. So it was disturbing that even after counter tweets, people still spread false information. Maybe people like to spread false information, so we wanted to test that. And so we had we collected true statement, debatable statement, and false statement, and we asked people, so in this case, we asked likelihood of sharing in 7-point scale, how likely is it that you're going to share this information? It turns out that false people are significantly less likely to spread false information and other kinds of information, so that's good news. So if people know that something is false, again, they're not going to spread it. And I don't have time, so. So all the figures with bars, I'm plotting 95% confidence intervals, if that makes sense to you. And so if there's no overlap, it's highly significant. Let's see. So yeah, so technique. So another technique we are testing is exposing people to information about truthfulness or credibility of information. Then we might be able to reduce the spread of false information. So we are testing something like this. We can actually, in Twitter, we might be able to just ask. So instead of like, dislike, we can have something like true, false. And if during disaster, if there's an option like this, we can quickly crowdsource this information. And by showing this collective opinion, maybe we might be able to reduce the spread of false information. Yeah.
But isn't it spread by collective opinion? Wouldn't it be like people will rate it as false and or are true because they believe it's true and just spread it? I mean,
that's a very good point. There will be some interaction. Also,
I mean, I get your point.
It depends on the wisdom of the crowd.
So it's still gonna spread.
Yeah, so it still might spread. But the question is a little different, so it might be possible. Yeah, we need to really test it. In the lab it works, but in the real life it might not. So like you said, you know, they're spreading, so that means they must be thinking that it's true. So then everyone might say just true, and then it's going to spread. So that might actually be very bad, because the next study shows that if you show retweet counts, that's going to influence when the retweet count is higher, typically you're more likely to spread. So that's going to be bad. But so another one close related to retweet count. So we studied this and we divided, it's the same type of statements we had, true and false, and we grouped based on whether people strongly think the statement is true to strongly think the statement is false. And it turns, and then we had the exposure to collective sharing decision. That's exactly like retweets, number of retweets. But yeah, so in this now case, we just show the other people's ratings. But when you do this, when people think something is very false, when you show the collective opinion, the real social sharing decision by others, it's going to reduce the spread a little more. So that's good news. But when they think it's true, it's going to increase the spread. So it really depends on how people are perceiving these tweets. And so, yeah, we need to find a way to manage all these different kinds of collective opinion in an optimal way during disasters. But so, if anything, though, this kind of shows that so even when people think these tweets are true, some are unverified and some are false. So if anything, if you just say that not so many people tweeted, or not so many people share, that would be the best option, it seems like. So yeah, presenting collective opinion that indicates that few people have shared might be good. So in this case, you know, few people share because people think it's false. So if you show that information, you can even reduce it, so that's good. And for, a lot of people think this is true and they share it, so yeah, goes up. But if you, I mean, in real world you can do it, but you kind of deceive people and say not so many people shared, and that's actually this inverse condition. You can actually reduce it. Yeah, Bucket.
What about a credibility score for the users?
Credibility
based on what they retweeted in the past.
Yeah, very good point. So yeah, that's going to be really useful. And there's another group of people actually studying credibility of people and try. In the end, we need to integrate everything in social media, and so that's where we are heading. But so yeah, that's so one thing I wanted to do: credibility of content and also users and number of followers of users and all the information. But the more I searched, you know, I find a lot of groups studying something similar. So instead of replicating it, maybe join them and integrate. Although replication is really important in doing research. And so, let's see. Yeah, so yeah, we did this. And changing perspective is actually one of the PhD students' work. But so we noticed in 9 minutes, So we noticed that, so there's a classic model of rumor spread, and it says rumor spread as a function of ambiguity, importance, and anxiety. How uncertain the situation is, the information is, how important it is to you, how relevant, and how anxious it makes you. And so we tried to fit this model for tweets in Japan and the USA, and we couldn't really, it was different. For rumors in Japan, it was just ambiguity and importance. It could have been because of the size of the disaster. Everything was, every information made people anxious, so there was no difference in that. So maybe anxiety wasn't so predictive of rumor spread for Japan. And in USA, it was anxiety and fluency. Fluency is how easy it is to process the information. It turns out that was really important for, not important, predictive of the spread. And so, so I guess the point is different people in different places, they behave differently. So maybe we can instruct people to think in different way or think like different person. And maybe that can change how they interact with tweets. And so, that's perspective affects sharing decision. So we did an experiment where, again, we had multiple conditions. One condition we said, so read this message. After reading this message, think what John, if John were in Fukushima, Fukushima was one of the disaster centers, would feel. And they wrote down how, imagine John in Fukushima and wrote down how that person would feel. And then after that, how likely is it that you will share this information? So you change the person's mind a little bit. And another condition was it was just you in Fukushima. And there was another condition where there was no location given. And so these participants were in United States, so the default thinking would be in the United States. And so what happened was when you imagined yourself in the disaster center, they decided to just share everything. Well, this is important, I'm going to share. If you let people think about another person, John, in Fukushima, actually, we were able to reduce the likelihood of sharing. And then, no instruction is just, they didn't, weren't given specific information. And that was about the same as thinking about another person in Fukushima. And then, she analyzed a little more. So, she had the feeling data, so she analyzed the sentiment. And it turns out, so one thing I want to mention is this arousal, how calm or excited you get after reading the message, was really predictive of whether you're going to share the message or not. And so everything, so arousal and likelihood of sharing on y-axis, everything goes up. And another thing was, if you think about the disaster location, everything becomes interested and scared and concerned. So this is, we didn't prime the location in this condition, and people were bored and good. Concern, so you can really change how people feel by making people. But so in the end, we want to improve social media, and so there's this big data related community, global research on applying information technologies to support effective disaster management. And so the idea is, social media data, big data. How would you, so we want to use the data to help disaster management, but in every step, so collecting data, storing, processing, analyzing, every step, there's a lot of challenges. So build this community and try to, I guess, this savvy grant is just about developing the community, but once we develop the community, we want to collaborate and advance this field. And actually, I'm a founding member of this. I'm involved. So for the analysis part, one of the big things is real-time data analysis, because what we are doing now is 2 years after the disaster, we are giving results, and that helps the next disaster, but not the one that happened. So we want to do everything real-time and actually help, and really real-time if it's A few minutes, that helps. If it takes a few hours, that's too late already in these disasters. So in Japan, actually, for the central part, they only had 15 seconds to evacuate. And so most people just died. They couldn't do anything in 15 seconds. And so yeah, for real-time collection of labeled data, and so for verification of information related to crisis, they are developing this crowdsourcing system. So this is one of the major ones. And I don't know if you guys remember the red balloon, DARPA red balloon challenge, where you were supposed to find unknown location of 9 red balloons within the United States. DARPA posted some balloons and we were supposed to find the exact location of that. But so there was a winning team from MIT, but they're collaborating together and they're trying to use the same winning algorithm to do this crisis information verification. And so that's one thing. And so you can crowdsource, so people are actually, you know, getting information and they are trying to verify it. This is in combination. It's really nice because here we get crowdsourced data and all the data are labeled now. This is credible, this is not credible. Verified, not verified. And they're using the data to train the machine learning algorithm and at the same time helping how to summarize this information automatically, very quickly. So here, I mean, both are fast, but this is a little slower using crowd. This is really fast, automatic machine learning way. And so if we can really reliably do this, it's going to help a lot. And they want to, I think they are trying to put this, they have some algorithm. They want to try to put it in Google website so that when the next disaster happens, they can test the system. And so, we're trying to collaborate with these people too. But so, I guess, so after credible, what's important is actionable again. There are a lot of credible information, but from that, you need to find what's actionable. And so, more categories. And it's about how to summarize it. And so, related to this actionable information, so part of it is you need to have detailed information, what, where, when, and who, and so on. And so the group of people created this web page that summarized different kinds of tweet, and they actually, the web page is inspired by the core journalism questions, and those are what, who, where, and when, and they try to summarize piece by piece. So a single tweet might not have all the information, but if you can, from different tweets, if you can just get what, all the details, that might be really helpful during disaster management. So in Japan, they're building this memory for future generations. They're collecting, crowdsourcing all these pictures and articles and their thoughts about related to Great East Japan earthquake. And this is, good for memory for future generations, but it's really good database to study too. We can collect data. It's open, so collect data and study it. And so I guess, one slow down. That's for me. But from all these, studies, so far what I want to say, think very slowly during disaster. You panic and you want to act very intuitively and quickly, but slow down and think carefully. So before you send something, just sit down and think, slow down. And thank you. So this is actually the deputy governor getting thank you note, and didn't want to depress you so much. That's my talk, so happy ending and colorful. And so,